But I do refer to the past. In fact, I wanted to show you something here. One of my pieces is based on this idea of the Mebius Strip, which was developed in the middle of the 19th century by a German scientist,
August Mebius.
He was contemporary to the Mexican War, the war that created the border
that
now exists between
the United States and Mexico.
If you take a strip of paper and connect it as I have,
you have an object that has two
sides. And intuition tells us that.
A very common expectation that we have two sides.
And if you then proceed to cut a line along the middle, because this object has two sides, we will have two separate objects when we're done. But if you take the same strip of paper, which initially has two sides, and which you're unable to go from one side to the other without crossing the edge here, if you take it and give it a 180-degree turn before you connect the ends, you have what is called a Mebius strip or a Mebius band. And it has some interesting properties. Essentially, this has only one side. And a demonstration of that property occurs when you attempt to do what was done earlier with the other loop, which had two sides. This having only one side, an interesting thing occurs when you arrive at the end of the cut. Intuition would say we're going to have two pieces, but since this only has one side, we wind up with one object still. And that object is the model for the piece behind me. Here, let me clear this stuff out of the way. Just put it over. You can just put it on the floor over there. This sculpture behind me is called Border Mebius, and it's a fence. It's a chain link fence that has been twisted into the shape of a Mebius band. And therefore, physically, we're able to do something that, to a certain extent, defies our intuition and what we know about fences and what we know about borders. We're able to cross through this fence from one side to exactly the same side. And even though you, the viewer, and myself, the artist, are separated by this fence, we're still standing on the same side of it. And I think that this is an analogy for the US-Mexico border, that in many ways, the separation is only an illusion.
South of the border, I rode back one day. There in a veil of white, by candlelight, she knelt to pray. The mission bells told me that I mustn't stay. South of the border,
San Diego and Tijuana are one thing. They're one metropolitan area. They're one border region. They're parts of one thing. In 1987, there's a real problem worldwide in people, governments, societies having to deal with this whole concept of border. What does a border mean? When via satellite communications, the information from one nation or society can enter the living rooms of people of another nation and society. What does a border mean when a pharmaceutical company, a transnational, can go to Africa and collect human blood, process it, and use it in various blood products that are used in another country altogether? It's a very old-fashioned idea, and it's something that needs to be redefined, and it's being redefined. It's being redefined here in the San Diego-Tijuana border region. And for the powers that be, for those who are unwilling to go into the 21st century without dragging the stinking carcass of manifest destiny into the next century, there's a real problem in maintaining the status quo. One of the pillars of, or one of the main weapons in the arsenal for those who do want to maintain the status quo here in the border is the San Diego Union, the newspaper of record for San Diego. It has a circulation of about 200,000 on weekdays and over 350,000 on weekends. Last year, Reagan signed a bill commonly referred to as Immigration Reform Act. And for a period of time, for 2 or 3 years prior to that signing, there was a great deal of national attention focused on the border. And the writers, the editors at the San Diego Union knew that. It's important to realize that the San Diego Union, a Copley newspaper owned by a woman by the name of Helen Copley, is managed by a bunch of Nixon retreads, Herb Klein and Jerry Warren. And the editor of the editorial page is a guy by the name of Ed Fike, who, I don't know if this really gives you an idea of what Ed Fike looks like, but when I think of Ed Fike, I think of this photo, this postcard here. Anyway, I want to read to you an editorial that Ed Fike put together last year while Congress was considering the Immigration Reform Act. Before it actually had decided to pass the bill, Ed Fike wrote an editorial commentary called "The Border at Tijuana, One Square Mile of Hell," and this appeared in the middle of last year. And he started out thusly, "The wire fence that Americans usually associate with the U.S.-Mexican border ends just beyond the San Ysidro crossing. Eastward of that official checkpoint, there is no barrier whatsoever. Tijuana and its worst slum, Colonia Libertad, crowd down to the invisible border and offer a perfect cover for illegal entry into the United States. An empty no-man's land about 1.5 miles wide on the U.S. side separates this teeming, reeking slum from San Diego, one of the richest cities in the richest state in the richest nation on earth." If, no, you don't have to go to those shots yet. I think it's, okay. I'll let you know, I'll tell you verbally when to go to them. What we're getting here from Fike is a real clear indication that the border is not merely the border between the United States and Mexico, it's a border between the United States and the third world. And in a sense, it's a border between the present and the future as represented by the United States and the past as represented by the third world. It's a rather tired notion of this linear development of societies with the United States and Western civilization, of course, being at the very top of the line. "This wild 6-mile stretch of canyons and mesas has been described as one square mile of hell," he continues, "and rightly so. It's like nothing else so much as a war zone. No other piece of real estate anywhere is invested with such terror, tragedy, and hope for so many human beings." I guess he hasn't heard of Iran and Iraq or the Soviet Union and Afghanistan or Israel and Lebanon, but this is supposed to be the most terrifying border in the world. "The danger and the uncontrolled conditions are without parallel at any other border in the world. And yet San Diegans are largely unaware of the dimensions of this horror. Small wonder that Washington is as unconcerned as it is ignorant of what is nothing less than a national peril and a national disgrace. By the hundreds and thousands, aliens emerge from Tijuana's tenements in the late afternoon of every day to await darkness and an illegal rush into the United States. The mesas and canyons are alive with people." This is the same no man's land he was referring to, which are now alive with people. "Mostly men, but also a surprising number of women and children. They gather in throngs on U.S. soil that the pitifully outnumbered, overwhelmed Border Patrol must concede to them in the no man's land." Okay, so having set this comforting picture for San Diegans, Fike goes on to play with some numbers, this statistical game of the statistical Ouija board, actually, that the Border Patrol plays with when it wants to frighten legislators. Last month, more than 70,000 undocumented aliens were apprehended here, an all-time record that is an astonishing 41% increase over the figure as recently as last January and 68% higher than the arrests in April a year ago. Indeed, illegal aliens caught here account for about 40% of all such arrests in the United States. And that's why San Diego has become such a focus of national and international attention. The Immigration and Naturalization Service estimates that for every illegal alien apprehended, another one or two or three make their way into this country. In other words, as many as 200,000 aliens each month are invading the United States at the San Diego border. It's always fascinating to me how the INS and the Border Patrol are more interested in conveying to the American public how many more Mexican workers come across the border than how many are being caught. And in fact, it's almost like their job is to make sure that every American understands that there is no border, that nobody's being stopped. And in fact, the only people they stop are the people they shoot. Because those people they do capture on Monday night are going to come back Tuesday night, and if they don't get through then, they're going to come back Wednesday night and Thursday night until they do get to San Diego or LA or Chicago or wherever they're going, because it's a lot easier to wait another day and give it another try than it is to go back to Oaxaca or Michoacan. But these figures he's playing with, how is the INS able to estimate how many people it doesn't catch? How are you able to count what you don't have in front of you, what you're unable to see? This is one of the properties, this is one of the characteristics of the INS, I think, that's always fascinated me. And this use of statistics in some kind of pseudo-scientific way is a game that the San Diego Union is willing, more than willing, to collaborate with. The illegal alien statistics and the trends they proclaim are truly staggering. Actually, the only thing staggering to me is the intellectual dishonesty represented here, but let's go on. Only 6,558 aliens were arrested for illegal entry here in 1965. That statistic soared to 427,772 last year. The 1965 is a year that the Border Patrol and the media like to point to. In 1986, there was over a million apprehensions. In 1965, according to this book, Los Mojados, the Wetback Story by Julian Zamora, the figure for 1965, all apprehensions, was 55,000. But for 1954, it was over a million. And in fact, figures in the 80s have been comparable to those in the 50s. But that's never pointed out, because in fact, in the 70s, fewer apprehensions were taking place than were taking place in the 50s. Yet you can't scare people by telling them, hey, it's less of a problem now than it was 20 or 30 years ago. So they selectively choose those years that are going to make the statistics look even more effective and more frightening. I think it's important to understand that with apprehensions, we're not talking about individuals. This individual that comes across on Monday and tries again Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday, possibly, before making it Friday, is counted four times. That's four apprehensions, but you're only talking about one person. So depending on the Border Patrol to get a sense of how many individuals are actually coming across the border is something like depending on Ferdinand Marcos to tell you how many voters there are. I mean, if Ferdinand Marcos tells you that he got a million votes, that doesn't necessarily mean that there were a million voters out there. It might have been, 10. Anyway, to continue. Although the vast majority came from Mexico during 1985, there were about 10,000 nationals from 72 other countries, including a number of communist, Arab, and third world countries hostile to the United States. If you're going to talk about countries that are hostile to the United States, you could probably include all of Europe and a lot of other places too. The nation's most porous border at San Diego, the most out of control, is an open invitation to terrorists. Terrorist is the operative word in the 80s. It's somehow communist is kind of passe and shopworn, but terrorist is a term that seems to mean an awful lot more, and it's always a license to do whatever you want to do. A person that's a terrorist, you've almost given a society a license to deal with that person any way they want to. Okay, it's an open invitation to terrorists, drug smugglers, and international criminals. And here's where we should go with that set of photos. Not the soccer field, not the ones of the, yeah, those two. These are a couple of photographs taken by a photographer here in San Diego by the name of Elizabeth Cisco at the exact location that Fike is talking about, this 1 square mile of hell, this war zone. And Elizabeth Cisco is a woman who, you know, must weigh about 110 pounds, and she goes into this 1 square mile of hell. It's interesting, she goes on her own. When photographers go in there escorted by the Border Patrol, they're asked sometimes to wear bulletproof vests, and the Border Patrol goes in there with shotguns to make sure that the photographer gets the point that this is, you know, 1 square mile of hell. Liz Cisco went in there armed only with her camera, protected only with a lens. These are the dregs of the earth and the enemies of freedom that Fike is talking about. Unlike the docile rural youths who crossed over from the South in years past, a majority of the illegals nowadays are street thugs from the urban slums of Mexico and other countries. One would think that the crime rate in those other countries must be dropping drastically if so many street thugs are leaving. They resist arrest, they shoot the Border Patrol, and some of them rob, rape, and murder their helpless companions in the canyon pass of no man's land. There is no knowing the number of persons who were terrorized and victimized by rampaging bandits until the Border Crime Prevention Unit composed of San Diego police officers and Border Patrol agents was organized. Okay, he goes on and he says, I visited the hell at our doorstep with Border Patrol officers during a recent afternoon and night of the full moon. Our first stop in the gathering dusk was a small knoll just north of the so-called soccer field. Okay, the soccer field, I guess we have to swing the camera back. The soccer field is called the soccer field because people actually play soccer there. I don't know if you want to get those photos. Do you? You want to pick up the photos? These are a couple of people walking through. You can see the goalposts there. And in this other photo, also taken by Elizabeth Cisco, you can see kids actually playing playing soccer in the soccer field. Okay, where multitudes of aliens were gathered awaiting darkness. It was a bizarre, unbelievable scene. A confrontation between a corporal's guard of Border Patrolmen and an immense army poised to invade this country. There's some other photos there. I guess Paul can show us the other photos of this immense army that was poised to invade the country. The soccer field's kind of a wonderful place. There's people selling tennis shoes, tacos. You can buy a shot of tequila to brace you if it's a particularly cold night, or you got to turn that one sideways, or buy a sweater. Here's a young man who's obviously trading in his shoes for a pair of tennies that are going to get him across the border a little bit better, a little bit quicker. But this is the immense army poised to invade this country. It's interesting, this use of military terms, this use of military language, war, a war zone, an invading army. Okay, there's never been anything like this in the entire history of the United States. It is incredible that this powerful nation passively tolerates such a gross violation of its sovereignty. Anyway, he goes on, and at the end of this editorial piece, he says, the militarization of the border already being discussed may well lie ahead in the absence of legislated immigration reform. This is the old carrot and stick approach, you know. The passage of the legislation is preferable to militarizing the border, although no one has said that it's guaranteeing that that won't take place anyway. San Diegans in the direct path of this increasing danger are challenged as few others to lead U.S. public opinion in demanding immigration reform this year. Let me see, I've got something here in my pile. This is a Xerox of an article that appeared in the Union. They begin televising the proceedings of the Senate in June of 86. And this is a story, the headline reads, Senator Hawkins calls border at San Diego a horror show. And this is from the Copy News Service, Dateline Washington. The international border at San Diego was singled out as a horror show during the opening day of televised proceedings in the Senate yesterday, with Senator Paula Hawkins, Republican from Florida, warning of undocumented aliens bringing disease, drugs, and the potential for terrorism into the United States. Hawkins said in a statement read for her on the Senate floor by Senator Strom Thurmond that if Immigration and Naturalization Service figures are accurate, up to 200,000 illegal aliens are invading our country each month in the San Diego area. Well, they then go on to quote, they bring with them diseases of the third world, drugs, and the potential for terrorism. This, what they're quoting from is Fike's editorial. So here you have his editorial making its way to Washington, D.C., being read on the Senate floor for the benefit of national viewers. And, you know, one of these lies, this lie of 200,000 illegal aliens are invading our country each month in the San Diego area. That's the figure that's arrived at when you take the actual number and you take that number of individuals and turn it into apprehensions, and then you multiply the apprehensions by this factor of 2, 3, or 4 that go get across undetected. So it's a completely fictitious number. Anyway, I think when I talk about the border being one thing, the border region being one thing, I like to compare it to the antebellum South in a plantation. It doesn't mean that all the parts that make up the border are equal. On the plantation, you had the field hand out under the sun, as well as the Southern Belle looking out her second story window of the plantation mansion. And it's an analogy, I think, that it's kind of interesting, that analogy. In September of 86, Fike wrote another opinion piece on Gone with the Wind, both the book and the film. And it's, you know, the disservice that his intellectual dishonesty, that his statistics, manipulation of statistics, the disservice that it does to this society and to history, and to any sense of history or community memory, I guess can be explained by how he views Gone with the Wind. Here's a quote from his piece on Gone with the Wind. As Gone with the Wind enthralls succeeding generations, it has been raised almost to the status of a Civil War documentary as history itself. That's not altogether bad, considering how so many know so little nowadays about U.S. and world history. So obviously, Fike has a little bit of trouble dealing with fiction and fact, and distinguishing between the two. Even with its romanticisms, Gone with the Wind qualifies in its own way as a Civil War documentary because it was based on personal recollections of the greatest tragedy yet to befall the American people. This, you know, the soccer field is kind of like the Universal Studios tour. The Border Patrol regularly schedules tours to the soccer field, and Harold Ezell, the Western Regional Commissioner of the INS, likes to take politicians out there, likes to take journalists out there, and he really gives them a show. You know, if you know when you're going to be out there, you can command all these vehicles to be driving around, and you can command helicopters to come in with their spotlights and so on and so forth, and you can capture a few people and bring them up and show them off as some sort of prize catch. And one of the writers in town, Joe Hawley from the Tribune, was taken on such a tour, and he quoted, here's a piece from that editorial, or that piece he wrote. Among them were Paul Gann, the co-author of Proposition 13, and Bill Butler. This is those who were included in the tour given by Harold Ezell. And Bill Butler, an Orange County resident and president of a group called Americans for Border Control. This is a lobbying group. It was organized, it was started by Harold Ezell, a law enforcement bureaucrat who works for the federal government, started this citizens lobbying group. I don't know how that's done legally, but apparently he gets away with it. The aliens, 33 in all, after a few stragglers were rounded up, sat on the ground while the Americans milled about and questioned the Border Patrol agents. TV journalists interviewed Cunningham, Butler, and Ezell. This is so exciting, an Orange County woman exclaimed. I think we should rent a bus and bring our friends down here every Saturday night. So it's like what's happening is this, as the border no longer ceases to function in economic terms and cultural terms, these fictions are created. And it's used in any number of ways. I don't know, Paul, you might want to put this one up over there, actually. This, it might be easier to see this one over here. Here's a front page story on the San Diego Union around Christmas time of last year, in which, you know, this no man's land, this 1 square mile of hell that Fike is ranting and raving about, is used to do a human interest story on how benevolent law enforcement officials are in San Diego, and it shows a San Diego police officer out there distributing Christmas goodies. And these are the photographs that editors like Fike must love. The woman is actually clasping her hands together as though in prayer. This depiction of law enforcement as some sort of guardian angel, it's really perverted, I think. To sum up, I think it's important to realize that this depiction of the border, this hysterical, xenophobic, racist writing on the part of Fike had something to do when it came to influencing the legislators in Washington, D.C., because it affected public opinion. And it was public opinion, finally, I think, that really got people in Washington, D.C. to move. I think that the agricultural interests in this country, the corporate interests in this country, the service sector of this country that benefits from the labor of Mexican workers would have been just as happy to see nothing done. But it was public opinion, I think, that played an important role. And I think since the bill has passed, and as Reagan stated on November 6th when he signed the bill, this bill, the Immigration Reform and Control Act of 1986, that I will sign in a few minutes, is the most comprehensive reform of our immigration laws since 1952. Okay, the last Immigration and Reform Act took place during the McCarthy era. And I think it's important to realize that this is also an era of great repression. And this focus on the border does a couple of things. What it does, first of all, it convinces the American public that they should be very much terrified by a lack of security. And the result is that the border becomes anywhere within U.S. society, anywhere within the continental United States, anywhere within the United States, where a Mexican and a non-Mexican happen to be, you have a border. The border is something that Mexicans and Chicanos carry with them. And it also means that we're in a period where the border is being redefined. And this presentation of the border as a war zone is this generation's reminder that Mexico lost a war to the United States in 1848. And that the United States still has a military capacity to do what it will, to have its way with Mexico.
And for a tender while I kiss the smile upon the face, for it was the end.
They focus attention on an issue, they turn it into a law enforcement problem, they frighten the public, and the result is American society is strapped with yet another repressive intrusion and insult from the law enforcement bureaucrats. Well, that's it. I don't want to read any more. I think we're running out of time. I'm David Avalos here in the border region, San Diego, Tijuana, asking you to remind yourself every now and then which side of the border you're really on.
South of the border, down Mexico way. Then she sighed as she whispered, "Mañana," never dreaming that we were parting. And I lied as I whispered, "Mañana," for our tomorrow never came. South of the border, I rode back one day. There in a veil of white black.
Excuse me, Gene, but we'd also like to thank the Border Arts Workshop, Taller de Arte Fronterizo, Margie Chandler, Siobhan McDonald, and Daniel Martin for the rolling footage. And tune in next week. Bye-bye.